Thank you very much, Ali. First of all, I'd like to welcome all the people who put in a lot of time to make this event here today possible. And I was privy to it because I was in communication with people. So I think the people who really, really should receive a lot of credit for this event, apart from Ali Dodd, is Mr. Behnam and Svemani Zadeh, who worked tirelessly. In addition to that, Mr. Ehsan and Yud Almaty worked very, very hard. And the other person who was absolutely critical to this was Ms. Shorten Hamidi. Thank you so much. It's very timely that we have this event here because we're dealing with a lot of very complex issues. And having spoken to many of you and to many friends here, I know a lot of us have had sleepless nights because there's so many issues on the table and it's very, very difficult to make sense of these very, very complex issues. So that having been said, initially I was asked to speak about the sanctions as a lawyer. But then, regrettably, we received a phone call this morning that Professor Zandi from York University cannot join us. And so I was advised at the time to actually speak about broader issues and not just talk about legal sanctions. So that having been said, I've never been known to make sense. But now that there's been a switch in the topics, it might very well be that my points are not exactly as precise as Professor John Lingley or Professor Hassan. But I look at the complex challenges we face as both an Iranian and a Canadian, and I can say that I'm very much disturbed by the pattern of developments, and that those two sides of me, whether it be the Iranian or the Canadian, are perfectly aligned. Being very critical of the approach that our government has adopted. So, I think before I get into what I deem to be the responsible position of the federal government, I should acknowledge two realities. I think the first reality is that one should accept that a lot of Canadians are very much concerned about developments in Iran and the reality that Iran may be developing nuclear weapons. That's the first point. And and perhaps it would be a good idea to say here that let's remember that Canada is one of the first countries in the world which had the opportunity and the option to develop nuclear weapons but chose not to do so. After the Second World War, Canada forewent the opportunity to develop nuclear weapons and to develop a nuclear arsenal. So we are a peace-loving country, and obviously a lot of Canadians are concerned. That's the first point I wanted to make. The second point I wanted to make to preface my remarks is that that we are dealing with a government in Iran which is not deemed to be a very credible player on the international stage. And of course, that's a reality that became known to every single Iranian several years ago when we had to deal with the tragic fate of Ms. Zahra Kazemi. So that's well known to a lot of Canadians. In addition to that, there are other incidents which fully demonstrate that we're not dealing with a very credible government in Iran. Of course, every single time Iran is under pressure, they call the Iranian diplomatic representatives in Tehran to the mat, so to speak, and criticize Canada. The things they criticize them on are things such as the G20 conference we had here, or on Aboriginal issues. Now, those are serious things. I don't want to belittle those issues, but I find it to be high comedy that the Iranian government can stand there and lecture the Canadian government. So those two qualifiers being in place, that first of all, Canadians have a legitimate right to be concerned, and also that Iran is not, you know, your ideal type of country to have to deal with on such sensitive issues. I'd like to say the following. What concerns me to no end is the fact that this particular government is constantly ratcheting up the rhetoric. How many times have people here in this auditorium and beyond heard this Prime Minister said that he is scared of Iran? I, for one, do not think that that is statesmanly, and I do not think it's responsible for any political leader to constantly emphasize those types of concerns to the general public. So I don't think it's incumbent upon this government to constantly resort to megaphone diplomacy. And I think they do so knowing full well that that obviously is not very effective, but only considering domestic Canadian politics and trying to make hay of an issue which is a very, very serious issue indeed. I think in addition to that, there are several other issues as well. The first one is, I think that the Canadian government should certainly distinguish between the Iranian government and the Iranian public. They don't do so, and they should make a point of doing so, whether it's Iranians here in Canada or whether it's Iranians back in Iran. The third thing is, they have demonstrated no willingness to actually communicate with Iranian Canadians. If you look at other countries, if you look at the Obama administration, if you look at Hillary Clinton, she goes out of her way to contact Iranian media outlets and to deal publicly with various Iranian specialists. That has certainly not been the case here in Canada. Lastly, I think it's quite laughable that this Prime Minister designated an individual, Mr. John Weston, who's an MP from Vancouver. A couple of years ago, this Prime Minister said, this gentleman, Mr. Weston, is my liaison with the Iranian Canadian community. Well, I can tell you full well that I know of very, very few Iranians who have heard from Mr. John Weston over the course of the past several months. And I think it's absolutely imperative that he reaches out to people like you and listens to what we have to say about these very significant issues. But as I said, I think this government is proving tone deaf. One issue, a few months ago, approximately 1,500 Iranians, and it included many distinguished guests, such as two of the panelists who are here, signed on to a petition that they sent to the Minister of Immigration. The Minister of Immigration has not even seen fit to acknowledge the fact that 1,500 Iranians have written to him on a particular issue. I think that's irresponsible. So, that having been said, getting into more specific issues, I think as a general issue when it comes to war, I think it's very, very irresponsible for the Prime Minister to constantly say that he is scared by Iran. We've also seen the same from the Minister of Defense, and we've also seen the same from the Minister of Foreign Affairs. Now, I should say that on November 12th, when the Globe and Mail actually reported on the remarks of several cabinet ministers in this country and how they were saying that Canada will stick to its allies should they intend to strike at Iran, I was immensely gratified to look at all those comments that went on the Globe and Mail website. I have never seen such an outpouring of concern by Canadians. Over 1,500 Canadians took the time to go to the Globe and Mail website and to criticize this government's approach to the issue of Iran, because I do not believe that Canadians for a second think that war is something to be taken lightly, and I think they expect the Canadian government to turn every stone before it intends to ratchet up the rhetoric or perhaps assist their allies. And I think we should applaud the Iranian Canadian Congress, which at the time when it saw those bellicose sentiments coming from the cabinet, it did take the leadership And it sent a letter to the government saying that it was their understanding that the vast majority of Iranians are against war. So thank you very, very much to ICC for having adopted such a great stance on this issue. The Canadian tradition in foreign affairs has always been to be a helpful fixer and to try, to the best of its abilities, to actually bring countries together, to work out a resolution. That is the Pearsonian tradition that so many Canadians are very, very proud of us, as Professor John Begley pointed out. That is our traditional role. Even if our own allies are very much concerned about developments elsewhere, instead of actually acting irresponsibly, what we have always done in our diplomatic history is to try to tell our friends to work out and resolve their differences. And I can give you several examples. When in the 1960s, the United States went to Vietnam, the Canadian government refused to go to Vietnam, and they took a lot of flak, but Prime Minister Pearson said, no, even if the U.S. is going to Vietnam, we're not supporting it. More recently, as you're all aware, a lot of countries went to war with Iraq. But at that particular point, Prime Minister Chrétien said, it's no business of Canada's to go to Iraq and wage war. And I think that was an incredibly popular thing for the government to do at the time. So I would hope that this particular government adopts the same approach when it comes to significant issues such as war. But that would be the first sentiments with regard to war. I would hope the government does not constantly resort to megaphone diplomacy. When it comes to sanctions, I think it's absolutely imperative that, to the extent possible at least, that this government attempt to introduce smart sanctions which do not have an impact on all Iranians, and that to the extent possible, they limit the application of these sanctions to members of the Iranian government, as opposed to bludgeoning the Iranian public, whether it be the Iranian public back in Iran, or whether it be the Iranian public here. They have adopted these measures, and our two other distinguished panelists will get more deeply into that, but I don't think these measures are a smart sanction. They're broad brush, 30 seconds. And lastly, the issue I'd like to emphasize is that the Canadian government should really consider how it can chisel these sanctions and make sure that to the extent possible that all of us are not victims of of sanctions of general application. They should try to expand the exemptions that have been included in that sanctions that they've introduced. It remains very, very vague at this particular point. And I think it is incumbent upon the bureaucrats of the government to actually reach out to us and try to taper in the exceptions to the sanctions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Assassi.